Let's have a look at the highlights from International Conference on Malignant Lymphoma on the current of spots and the more recent experiences on the use of checkpoint inhibitors in the setting of advanced stage Hodgkin lymphoma. The immune checkpoint inhibitors have shifted from an alternative treatment option to a first-line treatment, achieving a survival, a relevant fractions of survival rates in all the assistance settings. And we have to stress that the populations with the most significant potential for benefiting from these agents are those who are primary refractory or early relapsing disease, because we have an intact immune system not compromised by repeated lines of cytotoxic therapy. And currently, we need to better define in the setting of the biology of Hodgkin lymphoma the role of the checkpoint inhibitors, since they belong mostly to the world of the solid tumors. And so we have to clear better the physiopathological mechanism surrounding the action of these agents, so to give them their effectiveness at the full. And we have also to reduce side effects and to enucleate, to sort out the subsets of population that can benefit more from the use of these agents, and to adjust them into current treatment. And what can give us the checkpoint inhibitors in the first line setting, where we have still unmet need. And the unmet need are the need to overcome chemotherapy resistance that persists despite intensified regimens, and to reduce the treatment burden. And also, we have fractions of patients that are mostly out from the current toxic regimens. And so we have also patients that are poor candidates for standard chemotherapy. And this is an unaddressed need. And one can move on and think to that CPI inhibitors can replace chemotherapy in nearly favorable Hodgkin lymphoma patients, or serve to de-escalate in well-responding patients the treatment in nearly unfavorable, avoiding prolonged chemotherapy programs, or even removing radiation therapy. And in the advanced stage, can help reduce the cumulative exposure to conventional chemotherapy, or also to intensify the chemotherapy. We can need probably only 4 cycles of synergic checkpoint inhibitor plus ABCOP or AVD, so to have to achieve early a complete metabolic response, and limiting the use of alkylators and capping the use of doxorubicin to 280 per milligram square meter. And this is where we have started on checkpoint inhibitors in Lugano with this impressive data at 1 year on progression-free survival with NIVO-AVD. Anyway, we have to stand sometimes on this experience, because this is a seminal, so it may contain both the pitfalls and both the potential achievement that we can have in this with these agents. The conclusions of the researchers were that NIVO-AVD improved progression-free survival versus brentuximab AVD in patients with advanced stage disease. Few immune adverse events were observed, observed, and this is an important thing to observe, and less than 1% of patients received the radiotherapy. The achievement is that documented the better tolerability of PD-1 inhibition versus brentuximab, also in combination with a BVD. We have observed the tolerability among aged patients. We have seen the forest plot that was clear and significant to this aim. And this is an additional important thing. We have the potential for harmonizing pediatric and adult therapy in advanced Hodgkin lymphoma. And in the setting of pediatric patients, of adolescent patients, the limited amount of radiotherapy can reduce long-term sequelae due to consolidative radiation therapy in younger population. And although they may be more expensive in economical terms, they can abrogate the use of PET guidance and also the need to access to radiotherapy facilities or limit the need to radiotherapy facilities. Potential pitfalls are the median follow-up is not major. And we have indeed less than 6 months of observation after the end of treatment. And we know that recurrences in Hodgkin lymphoma may happen until 2 years from treatment completion. So it seems really too early. And one may wonder if the progression-free survival is carried by early responses to the PD-1 blockade, or to a true synergic effect between PD-1 blockade and chemotherapy. And this will translate into a maintenance with the time, with the passing time of the responses. Median age is lower than the trials for adults, so we have efficacy and safety profile that can be not easily compared to other trials. NAVD benefits we have seen is greatest in older patients was not significant in the forest plot for younger patients. In addition, we have to say that brentuximab BVD is not a standard in adolescent and young adult and in pediatric patients, where we have been observed very interesting results with brentuximab AVPC with a 3-year event-free survival of 92%, and this is the US standard of care in the pediatric population of Hodgkin lymphoma. And this probably would have challenged NIVO AVD. Anyway, if you look at additional trials that have been presented in Lugano on the use of checkpoint inhibitors, we can find clues of something new that is in the air. And first of all, we see additional experiences in the older adults, and we see that the NIVO AVD, this is a small sized study. Anyway, we have tolerability, and the treatment resulted highly effective. And most of all, we as only such kind of toxicity, febrile neutropenia in 5%, and immune-related adverse events, only grade 1 and 2. In an elderly population with Hodgkin lymphoma, this can be a real achievement. And in this case, we have a median follow-up of 3 years. Small-sized, but major results. And in this other study, considering the unfit patients unable to undergo in a BVD program due to comorbidity or aged more than 75. We see a median age of 77 years, small-sized, but high overall response rate, median duration of response that is relevant, 1 year overall survival about 40%, 90%, and it seems that even monotherapy with Pembro, with an anti-CPU, a checkpoint inhibitors, is feasible in ABVD unfit, elderly patients, and with comorbid risk score. And so the patients were also monitored for cumulative illness risk score at baseline and in the following, at the end of treatment. And so this is a new addition to the to the meaning of introducing such kind of agent in the older patients, even as a single agent. Let's go on. And this is a different experience. We have also in this case a more prolonged follow-up, 36 months, and show us how within a PET adapted program of a traditional kind, where we have two initial BVD, then PET scanning, PET negative can benefit from going on with additional ABVD cycle, such as in the RATOL study, PET adapted study. But PET positive, instead of being rescued by escalated BCOP or being rescued by salvage program with autologous stem cell transplantation, farewell with NIVO AVD for cycles, and we have progression-free survival at 2 years that are quite superimposable to the percentage that to the rates that we observed in the PET-adapted strategies when adopting PCOP. And this is an additional achievement, although I repeat, the study is small-sized, but these are clues of something new. And I guess, on the right, we have a trial that has been conducted in not in advanced stage patients, but in early stage. But I included it in the slide set because we have 144 patients, so we can evaluate also the association of nivolumab and brentuximab together, working together in terms of toxicity. And so we have get that no death occurred in this large cohort study. And we are we have an overall response rate approaching 100% and a complete response rate of 92% at the end of treatment. These are early stages. Anyway, the treatment was safe, and grade 3 immune-related adverse events were limited in number. So there is a promising efficacy and accepted the safety profile. We have no new safety signal. And now several experiences are going on using the a leading program. So they start treatment in advanced Hodgkin lymphoma with the checkpoint inhibitors, make a a picture of the situation of the response rate observed after this leading phase, and then go on with the traditional EPET adapted program with two initial ABVD, followed by escalated BICOP in partial responders on ABD for cycles for those PET negative. And the study endpoint was 40% overall response rate over avelumab, and the response was quite above the predefined threshold. And the results you can see on the right, the progression-free survival of all the patients at the median follow-up of 14 months, we have these results compared favorably with the results from RATO, where we had several, a fraction of PET2 negative patients that became positive at the end of treatment. This is an additional insight that can be proposed to the world of researchers in Hodgkin lymphoma. And a further experience on a smart start lead-in treatment, it is also real interesting. Beyond the only 28 patients that have been treated. As you can see, we have a leading phase with tislelizumab for two courses, a PET scanning, interim PET evaluation, and PET that previously went on to four additional AVD or ABVD treatment went on additional tislelizumab, chemo-free. And while progression responders had tislelizumab combined with a more traditional ABVD backbone, and eventual, if persisting PET positivity, additional two courses of the same treatment. Progressive disease went off of the study. And after the leading phase with tislelizumab, we had about 30% of complete responses as an overall response rate of 96%. And among the patients that went on tislelizumab when achieving PET negativity, 6 of 8 maintained their response going on. And so, the message can be that cytotoxic drugs can be reduced and even ignored in some patients with advanced stage of disease. This is an additional insight. And we move on, and we assume such results, and we say that we need responses to this unmet need. I think that reducing treatment burden, checkpoint inhibitors in such studies can give yes as a response. And yes, also for candidates for poor candidates for standard chemotherapy, we have seen some evidences that CPI inhibitors can make the difference in such setting of population. And to the study of SWOG, we can expect that it can overcome chemotherapy resistance, but the follow-up is too brief and pending evaluations can be also reserved to the small size study that we have described. We need a larger trials and probably new statistical tools to better evaluate such kind of of treatment. And what can give these agents in the setting of relapsed, recurrent, refractory patients. We see that in the slide from Ansel that there is no plateau phase, no flattening in curve, independently from the quality of response, complete, partial, or progressive disease. We don't have a fraction of patients that can be sorted out as cured. So probably in this setting, the efficacy of checkpoint inhibitors should be improved through alternative targeting to a combination with conventional cytotoxic drug and many highlights the abscopal effect of radiotherapy when coupled with the checkpoint inhibitors. And these are additional co-inhibitory receptors that can be targeted for improving the activity of checkpoint inhibitors. We have LEC3, TRIM3, that currently is also part of a trial with a bispecific antibody in advanced Hodgkin's disease, coupling anti-PD-1 and anti-TIM-3 activity. And TIGIT, and so I won't present only this experience. This is a trial started some years ago. Results were already available, and this is these are two updates. At an additional follow-up. And a dual blockade for patients that have been refractory to PD-1. One may wonder if the addition of a different checkpoint inhibition, in this case with anti-LAG-3 favezelimab, can restore a sensibility to checkpoint inhibitors. And we see that in the first cohort, no prior anti-PD-1. The second cohort of patients of the MK4280 study were had prior PD-1. 30 patients, 34 patients. And so with duration of response that can be almost superimposable. And also the duration of response in PD-1 already exposed patients is worth of attention. And progression-free survival is 33 months, that is considerable. And also overall survival is interesting. So with additional follow-up, the combination of the double blockade of PD-1 and LAG-3 continues to show activity and manageable safety in both the cohorts. And what is the real contribution of favezelimab to pembro-resistant patients? And we see that there is an average change from baseline target of 47% for with the addition of favezelimab, and in pembro only that resistant that continued treatment there was unchanged. So we have deeper responses with the combination of the two CPI inhibitors instead of going on with the same pembro, achieving only a clinical benefit. But we have also downsides. As we said before, we have studies that are often small-sized and non-randomized. And the use of CPIs frequently depends on the local licensing status and reimbursement mechanisms. And they are still a matter of solid tumors. If we look in the pipeline of several big companies, Sometimes we cannot find any CPI agent specifically devised for Hodgkin lymphoma patients, and Hodgkin lymphoma is not in the pipeline of several companies. So there is a long way to improve the use of such kind of agents in the world of Hodgkin lymphoma. We have also the challenge to on how to manage such kind of patients, because the immune response and the immune-related adverse events are two agents of the same sort. We have long-term toxicity, chronic toxicity, and also some fatal complications. We have emerging now a complex network of immune resistance. And the new problem of double refractoriness to brentuximab and to anti-PD-1. The immune response immunological related adverse events are due to the fact that there is that the shared T cell receptor sequences may be the main reason, so to have an immune attack on both tumor tissue and normal tissue. These events of toxicity vary depending on the different checkpoint inhibitors. So we have some that characterizes ipilimumab, some others that characterize PD-1 inhibitors such as hypothyroidism, pneumonitis. But with the introduction of novel CPIs, we have to observe if we have additional new kind of adverse events. This is the case for the reactive cutaneous capillary endothelial proliferation that is seen in more than 90% treated with camrelizumab.
One minute.
Thank you. And we have also some problem with the resistance. We studied the mechanisms, and we have observed that double refractoriness can be circumvented by some old agents like epigenetic modifying drugs. And so the use of immunotherapy continues to grow and evolve, but more research and time are needed to determine the future utility and long-term side effects in Hodgkin lymphoma. As said before, during Lugano, in a session, a researcher wondered, are we reaching the maximum cure rate for Hodgkin lymphoma? Well, I say yes and I say no. This is the real incidence at 2020 for Hodgkin lymphoma worldwide, and this is the mortality, estimated mortality rate. We are not on that kind of rates. And I believe, as said during the previous presentation, that more tolerable and effective therapies coupling with a less demanding care load can certainly be a good viaticum for a global improvement in the numbers of cure for patients with Hodgkin lymphoma. And in this setting, collaborative efforts are critical to success. That's all.